بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear brothers and sisters, this is your host Gibran Romani. Welcome to another episode. And we are discussing the topic of the middle path. Previously, we talked about extremism, how to stay away from extremism on both sides of the spectrums, how to follow the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, the clear path that was decreed for us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was exemplified in detail by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was practiced by his companions and those who came from the next generations, and how, you know, to engage our youth, the ones who are the target of extremism on both sides. People become very lenient, they don't practice Islam, they start committing sins and following their shahawat, their desires, and then the people who become too harsh and then leave the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, they think that they can do more than the Prophet ﷺ, more and have a better understanding than the Prophet and the companions, and they follow these shubahat, these doubts, yani, that lead them again into a different form of extremism. Today, my dear respected scholars, we want to give some practical tips, inshallah, and some advices to our brothers and our sisters, our viewers, on how to achieve the middle path then. How do we follow this sunnah, this wasatiyah, this middle path that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for us? And as always, jazakumullah khair for coming. Assalamu alaikum to all of you.
Alaikum salam.
Let us start with Sheikh Asim al-Hakim. How do we achieve the middle path? What are some steps that we can take, practical steps, bi-idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Okay, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa mahtada bihudahu amma ba'd. It is quite difficult to list how to be moderate, because you're talking about listing everything about Islam. And Islam is a religion of nature. And whenever you go against your nature, then you are not following the moderate path, you are in extreme. When we look at a hadith, for example, the Prophet ﷺ saw a rope dangling from the ceiling. And he said, what is this? They told him, it is for one of the mothers of the believers. She prays at night, and when she feels tired, she hangs up so that she could stand. This goes against your nature.
No.
Allah doesn't want you to kill yourself or to burden yourself. He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, untie it. When one has the agility, one has the power to pray, pray. And when you feel asleep, go ahead and sleep.
Subhanallah.
So if you look at aspects of aqidah, you'll find that there are extremes, and our way, Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, or the Salaf, or those who follow the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, is the middle path. So you have Khawarij and you have Murji'ah. They both contradict one another, though they all share the concept that Iman is a whole entity. Either it's there all the way or it's gone all the way. Islam, the real Islam, the modern Islam, differs with both extremes and says no. Iman increases and decreases depending on the good deeds and the sins. Now, when you look in ways and forms of purity, you have extremes. There are people who may pray without wudu. There are people who may pray with only washing half of the arm. And those who pray while spending half an hour performing wudu. So again, you have extremes. When you come to things that are permissible to eat, Sheikh Ahmed mentioned that there are those who make life impossible and say, no, it's haram to eat meat. You have to be a vegetarian. And there are those who don't care what kind of meat you eat, whether it's dead or of a swine or whatever. It's all meat. Let's eat. So you have so many tendencies around that it is extremely difficult to follow the right path if you don't have knowledge. With knowledge, your darkness becomes light. With knowledge, your confusion becomes reality and certainty. But when you don't have knowledge, it's an easy fall. And sometimes it's a spiral downfall into hell because you don't know what to do. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, may Allah be pleased with him, he was a great companion of the Prophet ﷺ. Young, enthusiastic, knowledgeable, and he used to write down everything that the Prophet used to say or do. Abu Huraira says that Abdullah and I were competing in narrating hadith. I used to memorize, but Abdullah used to write. Abdullah ibn Amr, his father, they say that the difference in age is about 11 years between the father and the son.
MashaAllah.
Well, let's assume it's more than that, but his father, Amr ibn al-As, was one of the great Arabs, intellectual Arabs, very keen and clever. He wanted to get his son married. So he chose a woman from a good family in Mecca, and they got them married. A few weeks later, he goes and checks upon his son, and he finds his daughter-in-law. So he asks her, "How is Abdullah with you?" And this Qurayshi woman was a woman of any noble family. She said, "MashaAllah, he fasts all day and prays all night. He's a righteous man." Amr ibn al-As is not
smart,
sucking his thumb. he's a genius. He immediately took the message and understood it. That this man, 2 weeks after marriage, until now he did not even touch me.
Allah.
No consummation.
So he goes immediately to the Prophet because he knows his son, in a sense, is a hopeless case. In the sense that he loves Allah Azza wa Jal to the extent that he would think and believe that what I'm doing is the right thing. So he goes to the Prophet and complains. The Prophet summons Abdullah and he asks him a few questions without going into details. Abdullah says, "I pray all night and I finish the Quran once every night." Give me a break. I know Muslims that have not finished the Quran from cover to cover except in 5 years. You ask the brother, "Akhi, when was the last time you finished Quran?" "Three Ramadans ago." "And how many times do you finish it in Ramadan?" He said, "I don't. It takes me like a couple of Ramadans, three Ramadans." And he prays it once every night. And the Prophet told him, "Don't do this. Pray it once at least every week, and in another narration, once every 3 days." "How much do you fast?" He said, "Every single day. I fast every single day. I never skip a day." The Prophet said, "No, fast 3 days a month." And then he went with him to the max, which is every alternate day, the fasting of Dawood. And then the Prophet gave him the golden rule, which we must apply. He says, "Abdullah, إِنَّ لِرَبِّكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا." Allah has rights over you. وَلِجَسَدِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا. And your body has rights over you. وَلِزَوْرِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا. And your guest has rights over you. وَلِأَهْلِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقًّا. And your family has rights over your wife, your children. The Prophet ﷺ, so give each its due right. The same incident took place with Salman al-Farisi and Abu Darda. And it's in the Sahih. And Abu Darda complained to the Prophet ﷺ that Salman gave him the same advice. The Prophet said, Salman had said the truth. This golden rule of being moderate, of being natural, if you pray all night long, you can't do that. Do you think you will last for long?
Never.
It will affect everything around you. It has a ripple effect. Maybe you will manage to do it a month, two, a year or two, but then it would start to affect everything. And the Prophet said, إِنَّ لِكُلِّ عَمَلٍ شَرَّ. Each deed, whether good or bad, Islamic or un-Islamic, it has a peak. وَإِنَّ لِكُلِّ شِرَّةٍ فَتْرَ. And each peak has a downfall, has a bottom level that it would reach. So this is human nature. If you start to embrace Islam and practice it, you feel like strong. But then there is a downfall to it. The Prophet said, فَمَنْ كَانَتْ فَتْرَتُهُ إِلَى سُنَّتِي فَقَدْ اهْتَدَى. Now whoever his downfall is to my sunnah, then you're guided. What does that mean? Your peak was to pray 6 hours a day. Your downfall to the sunnah is that you pray witr before you go to bed, or at least you don't miss witr per night. But your downfall would be that you quit praying altogether.
Yes.
So the Prophet says that this is the moderation, level of moderation is his sunnah. And the Prophet says, وَمَنْ كَانَتْ فَتْرَتُهُ إِلَى غَيْرِ ذَٰلِكَ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ وَهَلَكَ. And whoever his fatigue, his lack of interest is to other than my sunnah, then he has gone astray and he's doomed.
MashaAllah. Would you like to comment on this, anyone?
There's no comment except another hadith where the Prophet ﷺ is addressing the youth and the Muslims in general by telling them, إِنَّ هَذَا الدِّينَ مَتِينَ فَأَوْغُلُوا فِيهِ بِرِفْقٍ. This deen, this religion, is so vast. You can't do everything. So take it slowly, gradually. I have seen many youngsters, when they started practicing Islam, mashallah, immediately short thawb and kuhul and these and mashallah, mashallah. And later on, they flipped. Many sisters from day one, gloves, niqab, and they take it too much. That goes against the fitrah. You have to go in gradually,
step by step,
slowly. Step by step.
MashaAllah. We're going to take a short break, inshallah, and we'll be right back discussing the issue of reaching the middle path here on Peace TV. We'll be right back after this break.
God is great.
Annual Day event.
Welcome you to the grand finale of the Islamic International School.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Performances par excellence, recitations soul stirring.
Man finds means for momentary pleasure when I am with him and goes astray.
They are the enemy, so beware of them.
This is the summary of our Kregan expenses this month.
And don't you forget who's the boss.
Watch these cool kids impress and uplift your hearts, your minds, and your iman.
With Allah's help, this will be a memorable event.
Wiz Kids, next on Peace TV.
God is great.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. Just before the break, we were talking about steps in achieving this middle path that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for us. And I believe probably the first thing is knowledge, having knowledge, and knowing what this path is. How can you achieve something if you do not know what you're going towards or what does it look like? So having knowledge. And before the break, we're talking with Sheikh Salim. I believe if I'm taking the right point, it would be gradualism. Would be the next point in achieving the right. Would you like to elaborate a little bit more on that?
Inshallah? Alhamdulillah. See, first of all, we have to understand the obligations in Islam. The obligation in Islam, they are furud, so they, you have to prioritize, and they are sunan. So what is obligatory takes the first priority. So you need to sort out the priorities, though all are part of the deen. But if you equate all of them and you want to do them all in one go, you'll find difficulty. That's why the youth, they need guidance and they need someone to tell them, take it easy.
Hold your horses.
Hold your horses. It's a long way. It's a long way to go. That's why Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As radiallahu anhuma, towards the end of his life, said, I wished I had accepted the piece of advice. Because now he's old. Huh? He couldn't do what he used to do. That's why the other hadith, the one who is beating his horse or his camel, his mount, through the journey, for the camel or the horse to speed up, he will not reach his destination because his mount will collapse.
SubhanAllah.
See?
Animal rights right there.
Yeah, his mount will collapse.
And he has not saved his animal.
And his animal. So that's why Islam, my dear brothers and sisters, okay, the Prophet ﷺ, when he was teaching the Arabi who came and embraced Islam, he taught him the five prayers. That's it. He said, and I will enter the Jannah. Yeah. By Allah, I will not.
Aflaha in sadaq.
Aflaha in sadaq. I will not add any single rak'ah. And the Prophet ﷺ said, indeed, he will be successful if he is telling the truth that he will pray these five prayers and not missing them. So the problem that without the knowledge, you don't know how to sort out and how to prioritize and which comes before the other. That's why Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he mentioned, لا يكون العالم عالما حتى يعرف خير الخيرين وشر الشرين. You will not be considered as a scholar unless you know which deed is more rewardable than the other, good deeds, but which one has more reward than the other, and which evils is less than the other.
SubhanAllah.
If you cannot differentiate, you are not alim.
SubhanAllah, this reminds me of a trend that I personally passed through it, and I see a lot of the youngsters pass through it when it comes to religious commitment. When Allah Azza wa Jal guides us in the very beginning, we tend to find those who are newly committed to the religion to be tough, rough, rude. And a lot of the people are agitated and they don't like what they see. And they have all the right not to like what they see because this is not proper Islam. But if you analyze this, it is like when you're carrying a piece of jewel in your hand and someone says, excuse me, what's the time? And you think that he wants to take your jewel. So you start to be a little bit aggressive or defensive. And this is due to lack of knowledge. The more you get knowledge and you get to understand the wisdom and how to be wise, the more you tend to loosen your grip, but to put the jewel where it should be put. And this is why when we started to practice Islam at the very beginning, we had our priorities mixed up. So wearing the hijab for a sister is not questionable. This is a fard. But going to extremes in being disrespectful to your mom because she's listening to music, this is totally unacceptable and your hijab has nothing to do with this. So you have this mixed emotions and wrong priorities. A brother wearing the beard, mashallah, this is mandatory. We have no question in that. But at the same time, he is abusive to his wife. He beats her up. He slanders her, thinking that he's disciplining her. Or he's abusive to his neighbor. Why? He doesn't give salam. Okay, mashallah, you have a long beard or you look like a Muslim. Why don't you give salam to your neighbor? Or I haven't seen them pray. So this doesn't make them kafir. Maybe they pray when you don't see them. No. Whoever abandons prayer is a kafir. This type of extremism, of jumping the gun, of cascading so many thoughts and building on them judgments is what's killing us. So I am a youth. Let me think. How can I start to do damage? Oh, the Muslim ruler of my country is kafir. Why? Because he has a lot of allegiance to kafir countries. And this means that his ministers are kafirs as well because they're approving him. And the soldiers are kafir because they're protecting them. And the police force is kafir. And the family of the police force and the children are kafir because they are approving their parents. And the whole society is kafir. So who's left? Me and you. And by the way, your prayer is not that good.
That's why I'm only one.
There's a funny incident that just reminded me. I know one of the sheikhs was telling us that he was personally with one guy entering the haram. And this guy seriously turned to him and says, brother, I honestly believe that everyone here except you and I are kafir.
And he's like, so it's not strange.
SubhanAllah.
I feel moderation or being in the middle path is simpler than sometimes what we think.
No.
It's basically to do what Allah has commanded you to do and abstain from what Allah prohibits you from doing. It's very simple. But if you'd like to do the extra, that comes in the next step. Mm. That's why you need to take things easily and you have to train yourself. It does take time and effort and you need the help of others. And don't have these ill thoughts of other people around you, thinking that I'm the best, I can do, you know, more than anyone else. You feel so much this arrogance within you, thinking that you're the best practicing person of Islam, and the others are just nothing.
Judging others.
That's the problem. I think if you limit yourself to doing the obligations first, doing your salah on time in congregation as a man, or as a woman during time, and doing it in the right way, and fulfilling all the other obligations, starting with the pillars of the faith, giving zakah, fasting the month of Ramadan, making hajj if you're able to do so. These are the basics. And then you abstain from prohibitions. You don't involve yourself in riba, in lying, in fornication, all of the terrible things that we are asked to stay away from. I think that you recognize the right path and you're doing it. But if you start mixing up things, as our brothers already said, then you really don't have a compass to go by. Then you're lost. That's why you start to equate sunnah with fard, and you try to, you know, overdo certain things at the expense of other things. But if you are waqaf inda hududillah, you are a person who sees the limits and stops there, that is going to make you, hopefully, the description or the right path of what you need to do. It's just very, very simple. Follow these things and you'll be safe.
Well, we have about 2 minutes, inshallah. Just from a family perspective, people who are watching here, a father, a mother, and so on, maybe grandparents, they say, how can we as a family take some steps towards achieving this middle path, this way that the Prophet ﷺ gave us? Maybe.
I believe that it is essential for the family to have communication. Extremism thrives on lack of communication. When your child is unable to voice his thoughts to you and get guidance, we tend not to listen to our kids. Daddy, I'd like to talk about, they take 50 riyals and go and buy some candies. I don't feel like talking to you. Or reprimanding whenever he says something that I feel is not right. Are you crazy? You're kafir? You don't pray Fajr today. Get away from my face. We have a big problem. So we have to start to communicate with our kids. And this is essential. I've met in one Southeastern country I was in recently, and I met two of the takfiris. And they came posing the question where they usually expect the sheikh or the da'i to give them a lecture that we all know of obeying the wali al-amr of this, of that. Yeah. And I've met so many of them. So I said, by turning the table to them, said, wallahi akhi, what you're saying is a good question, but what do you think the answer should be? Can you give me a couple of scenarios? And he refrained. Because he knows that if he talks, he's going to reveal himself.
Expose himself, yeah.
Therefore, we need to listen more than talking, especially to these extremists. Let them talk. Okay, let's see what you have. And then we will try to refute what you're saying. So the family needs this communication. They need a lot of knowledge. They need to be injected with lots and lots of the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ. When we connect our children, our wives, to the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, then they will be, inshallah, safe.
Inshallah. Yes.
Quickly, the knowledge is the, inshallah, the solution, the ilm, to immunize the children, to give them immunity.
Immunization, yes.
So they know they have brought up that this is the Islam and what is said is nonsense. They know it.
No. MashaAllah. Jazakumullah khair again. A very beneficial episode. And we hope that you, the audience, benefited from this. We leave you again with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we'll see you on the next episode. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.